are the same God. You are the same God. You answered prayers back then, and you will answer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were providing then. You are providing now. You are the same.
You moved in power then, God moved in power. time it rains, and it's from heaven.
Shoo-be-doo-be.
Don't you know each cloud contains banners from heaven?
Shoo-be-doo-be.
Merry Christmas.
You'll find your fortune
so
beautiful. Be sure that your umbrella is up.
Do you know Greaser?
Trading for a package of sunshine and ravioli.
Macaroni.
If you want the things you love, you must have a pizza holy baby. And when you hear thunder, don't run under a tree. There'll be pennies from heaven for you and me. Now come over here, boy, Sam. And every time it rains. And don't you know it's crocodiles? Every time it rains, and don't you know it's crocodiles? You'll find your fortune falling. All over town, all over town, all over town. Be sure that your umbrella is upside down and sweet lip up. Zooty hoes are right. Giggle, I'm a hungly. Zoomaloo, the super root. Oh, Bartley boys, oi. Hey, Baba, ha, boy. Ooh, Bada, ha, man. Hooty, woo. Ooh. I knew I'd get you, I knew I'd get you. Let's go, let's go. Let's go.
Well, hey, Merry Christmas, everybody. That was backed by popular man, our own Pastor Ben the Elf. That was a lot of fun. So welcome to the Journey Community Church. If you are a first-time guest here tonight, thank you for being here to celebrate Christmas with us. My name's Sean. I'm the lead pastor, and we're just really excited. I'm actually really excited that you guys are here at 5:30 because I thought 5:30 would be overwhelming, and if you'd have shown up at 4 o'clock, there wasn't an empty seat. So this is a lot better that you guys chose correctly. So thank you for doing that. Tonight is all about Jesus. That's what we're going to focus on. I know the kids are excited, and so we're not going to take up a lot of your time tonight, but we want to kind of help your minds get shifted and focused in the right direction. And before we do that, I want to just go over two quick things with you. We're going to give you our journey challenge. This is the challenge I try to give at the end of every year. And so the journey challenge is this. Try to come back, especially if you're a guest. We want you to come back, and we want you to bring people with you. Next Sunday, we don't have a worship gathering because we take that Sunday off the last Sunday of the year. My family and I, we travel. A lot of our staff travels from being around here. And we give our volunteers just a break. And so that's our chance to have a little break. But then January 7th, we moved to two worship gatherings. So we just had new cards printed up with our new worship times. And so I'm going to give these to you as you leave. And hopefully you'll hand those out and bring somebody back with you on the 7th. So that's my challenge to you. But also, I want to talk to you about LifeWise real fast. We're going to take up an offering here in a moment. And people ask, you receive an offering on Christmas Eve? There's a lot of guests and people don't go to church. We do it on purpose. Let me explain why. What I've learned in my many, many years of ministry is that even people who are not followers of Jesus, they still like to help in the community. They still like to give to see great things happen. So one of the things we do every year is we receive an offering at Christmas Eve, and we give 100% of that away. And so we always try to give it towards an organization in the community that focuses on kids. So this year, we've got LifeWise Academy. If you don't know what LifeWise Academy is, 1952, the Supreme Court ruled that you can, are you ready for this? You can have Bible education to public school students during school hours. This is insane. Like, why have we waited 71 years to start doing something with this? But an organization has started LifeWise, and so we've been spearheading it with some other churches in our community to bring LifeWise to Miamisburg. We met with the superintendent just this past week, and we got the thumbs up from our superintendent here in Miamisburg. So, yeah, that's something to get excited about. So, March the 4th, we're soft launching LifeWise. Actually, here in this building with students from Kinder Elementary. And so we'll be bringing second graders in to kind of work the bugs out until the end of school. And then we'll be launching in more schools and more grades next fall. So if you want to give to LifeWise Academy, you got one of these envelopes. If you didn't get one, grab one from outside or look around and put that offering in here, because every penny that comes to LifeWise is going to LifeWise, every penny of it. And so maybe you're here and you're like, well, I'm not prepared to give. I don't have my wallet. I don't have my checkbook. You can go onto our website on the giving tab. There's a LifeWise drop-down menu. You can drop it down and give that to LifeWise. 100% of that goes to LifeWise. Now, here's why I say that. I don't want anybody to be confused. It's Sunday. We still have an operating budget. So as we receive an offering, anything that's not in a LifeWise envelope is just going to go towards our general giving, okay? So if you're like, well, I want to give, but I want it to go to LifeWise, please go grab you one of these envelopes and throw that in the offering buckets as they come by here in just a moment, okay? So I'm going to shut up now. I'm going to pray, and then I'll shut up, and then we're going to just continue to worship. So would you pray with me? Father in heaven, I'm incredibly grateful for this opportunity that we have to come and worship you tonight. This is one of our kind of our last acts tonight before we celebrate the birth of Jesus. And I know that for many of us, my house included, we're going to be ripping open Christmas presents with kids, and we're going to be celebrating the non-spiritual side of Christmas, God. But I don't want us to forget about the spiritual side. I don't want us to forget the reason that we have hope is because of the rescue plan that you enacted on this night when you sent yourself into this world to be born as a baby, and his name is Jesus. And so we thank you for that. Father, as we get ready to give back to you, I pray, God, that you would take what we have and multiply it. Thank you for LifeWise Academy. Thank you for those who have created this program so we can teach your word to students during the school day. What an amazing gift that is. God, we love you. And I pray all this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. One thing I do want to say, I'm going to invite our ushers to come forward and begin to receive that offering. And as they're receiving the offering, I do want to throw out one more thing. The caveat to LifeWise. In order for LifeWise to exist, it has to have three things. It has to be off-school property, it has to be privately funded, and it has to have students have to have their parents' permission. So this is not something where we will be in the school buildings. The kids will leave the school. They'll come here. So every dollar helps privately fund that. And so I know us and a few other churches are going to be giving towards that as well.
Let's stand together. We sing the praises to our Lord.
Every
Please be seated.
Christmas changed the Grouch. In a church youth group just down the hall, down the stairs, and careful, don't fall, was a room full of teens decorating for the season. For it was Christmas, that was the reason. Not professionals, but they did what they could. Then proudly stepped back, and there they stood. When a skeptical Greg rolled his eyes like the Grinch.
That just looks sad,
he said, scrunching his face in a pinch. Greg the Grouch was big, nasty, and loud, always seeming to hate on the crowd. When a small, quiet girl decided to speak up, for she decided she'd had enough. Most other teens called her half-pint Haley, but she did not mind. She heard it on the daily. The timid, concerned girl became bold and asked,
"Hey, what's up with you?"
"Me? I'll give you a clue."
Then Greg rose up with an angry, mad clatter.
"Why do I just tell you the matter? I do not like Christmas, not at all, Haley. I don't like Christmas even worse of lately. I do not like it, I fear, once a year. Not the big shiny tree, not the gifts for me. I hate Christmas time with the Sydney Hayes rhymes."
"Rhyming's the absolute worst. But what about the gift?"
Haley asked with concern.
"That's the worst part,"
sneered Greg with a turn.
"Gifts can be lame, luck sucks for a time, but even video games come out there and die. What does a baby have to do with this holiday? What about Santa, the reindeer, and the sleigh?"
"You mean the fat guy that comes down the chimney? Come on, Greg. Don't be silly. We're talking about Jesus who died for our sins. He forgives us when we screw up, even the twins."
"Sorry." "The twins might be a great bit of trouble, but he'll help us the hard times when we struggle."
"So this guy Jesus forgives all my sins, even if I'm grumpy at Christmas again?"
"Exactly, Greg. Now you're rolling. He'll give you a spirit of joy like Nolan."
"I love Christmas!" "Gather around, everybody. We'll read it together. By the end of your hope, we'll be light as a feather."
The gift of love was shared and started to grow. It grew and grew like inches of snow. Sometimes we forget with all the bustle and cheer that Christmas is not just about the reindeer. God sent his son to live here in the world. He was willing to die for every boy and girl. So if you get a gift like socks or a tie, don't be disappointed, for they aren't the reason why. We give gifts on this day to remember the one. The gift God gave us was his one and only son. Old Saint Nick can't bring you joy. Joy is not found in a toy. Joy comes from Jesus, who is the reason. I'll say it again, and don't you forget, Jesus is the reason for the season.
You know, it's interesting to me that they talked about the story. I want to tell you a little bit more about that story. Because, see, God had a rescue plan. God's rescue plan wasn't like every other person's rescue plan. So let me set this up for you a little bit. The Jews expected the Savior of the world to come down and fight. They were looking for a warrior. They were looking for somebody who would overthrow the Roman government, the government that had been oppressing them their whole lives. And so they expected this big fight, but that's not what God did. So the question is, as they read this story to Greg the Grouch, what was it that God did? And so I want you to listen to John chapter 1. Now, this is not typically the passage that most pastors are going to go to on Christmas, but I want to walk you through the four Gospels. And I want to paint a picture for you tonight of what God's out-of-the-box story looked like. So John chapter 1, listen to what he says. He says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. All things were created through him, and apart from him, not one thing was created that has been created. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. That life shines in the darkness, and yet the darkness did not overcome it." If you shoot down to verse 14, it says, "The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We observe his glory, the glory of the one and only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth." See, I don't want you to miss what's going on in this story. He talks about his rescue plan was to shine a light so bright that everybody could see it. And so this light is referenced all throughout the gospel story. As you go from one gospel to the other, it talks about different types of light. Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2 is typically where people would go as they start reading the birth story of Jesus. But when we talk about God's rescue plan, think outside the box a little bit. Think about what God did when he said, "You know what? If I have to go rescue my people, I'll just go myself. I'll go in the form of a man." And so the Word became flesh, and he dwelt among us. Luke chapter 2 tells us how he did it. Verse 4, "Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and family line of David, to be registered along with Mary, who was engaged to him and was pregnant. While they were there, the time came for her to give birth. Then she gave birth to her firstborn son, and she wrapped him tightly in cloth and laid him in a manger. And because there was no guest room available for them. In the same region, the shepherds were staying out in the fields and keeping watch at night over their flock. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Don't be afraid, for look, I proclaim to you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the city of David, a Savior was born for you, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be the sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped tightly in cloth and lying in a manger.' Suddenly there was a multitude of the heavenly hosts with the angel praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest heaven and peace on earth to people he favors.'" It was night. It was dark. And when the angel showed up to the shepherds as they were tending their flock, what does it say here in verse 9? It says that the glory of the Lord shone around them. There's that bright light, the same light that we see that God is coming to light the world for all of us. Matthew adds another piece of the story. As you go into Matthew chapter 2, Matthew talks about the birth. He talks about the wise men coming after Jesus is born. It says, "After Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of King Herod, wise men from the east arrived in Jerusalem saying, 'Where is he who is born for the King of the Jews? For we saw his star at its rising. We have come to worship him.'" There's that bright light again. We see it over and over and over. How did the wise men find Jesus? They followed a star in the sky. Think about the journey for the wise men. If you don't know what that would have looked like in biblical times, that could have taken weeks, months, years even. We don't know. We just know they came from really, really far away. I'm one of these guys who chases a lot of rabbits. Why am I doing this? Did you know that they were from Alabama? It says because they came in their like their fire department suits, because it says that they all came from afar. Sorry, I'm a hillbilly from the South. I just couldn't resist that. Like, I don't know why. Squirrel, it's whatever it is. But this was not an ordinary star. As they were traveling and following this thing, this was one of those things where as they came, the light shined to a place where they found King Jesus and they worshiped him. See, listen to me. Don't get caught up in my ranting. God thought outside the box. He didn't come to fight, but instead came to the earth in the opposite form. He came to earth as a baby. Like, how intimidating is a baby? And young parents, you might be like, "That's very intimidating." You survived. You're okay, right? We got this. But a baby is not intimidating. A baby is not offensive. And yet that was God's plan. That was his plan A, to save his people. It's probably not the plan that you and I would have used. It's probably not the plan that the wise men would have used. But that was God's plan, and it was the perfect plan. It was a plan to save everybody back then, today, in the future. That was God's plan. And many people experience this rescue because somebody's thinking outside the box. And somebody takes the gospel to somebody else. And that very first Christmas started it all. I want to share one of my favorite stories with you out of the gospel that we haven't talked about yet. The Gospel of Mark. And this is not the Christmas story. This is nothing to do with the birth of Jesus. But as we talk about how God thought outside the box, I want you to think through this for a minute. I want you to think through. Let me set it up for you. There's a guy who's lame. The Bible talks about him laying there. And so he's a beggar. He's sitting on his mat. He can't get up. He can't walk. He can't do anything until his friends show up. And so his friends show up and they're like, hey, I've got an idea. Jesus is home. We're going to take you to Jesus. And so they pick up their friend on his mat and they walk him to Jesus' home where Jesus is teaching the God. He's teaching the Bible. He's teaching the scriptures to people. And the place is so packed, they can't get in the door. Listen to me. That's where most of us give up. That's where most of us hit a roadblock and we think we're done. But not these guys. Because what'd they do? They thought outside the box. And they were like, I got an idea. Let's climb on this dude's roof. Let's vandalize it a little bit. Let's cut a hole in the roof. And let's lower our friend down in front of Jesus. Because they understood something. If we can just get our friend in front of Jesus, Jesus will do the rest. And I want you to listen to what happens here in Mark chapter 2. I lost my place. When he entered Capernaum again, talking about Jesus after some days, it was reported that he was at home. So many people gathered together there, and there was no more room, not even in the doorway. He was speaking the word to them. They came to him bringing a paralytic carried by four of them. Since they were not able to bring him to Jesus because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him, and after digging through it, they lowered the mat on which the paralytic was lying. Don't miss this part. Seeing their faith, Jesus told the paralytic, son, your sins are forgiven. Did you catch it? Because somebody thought outside the box, this man was healed. They didn't beg Jesus to heal him. They didn't plead with Jesus of what they needed. They didn't lower him down and go, hey, Jesus, this is our buddy. It's my dude right here, as you might say. I need you to heal him. He can't walk. Jesus is like, I got this. You don't have to tell me anything. And they didn't. They just lowered him in front of Jesus and they stepped back. And Jesus says, your sins are forgiven. Pick up your mat and walk. And he heals him just like that. Can I be real with you for a minute? Real is something that we take serious at the journey. That's why we talk about real hope for real people from a real God. This series we just went through, the best gift ever. We talked about real hope for real people who can really change. That's all because we serve a real God. And so I want to be real with you for a minute. There's a reason we brought these kids up on stage. It's because we were kind of hoping they would do something stupid, all right? We were kind of hoping like they'd put their hands in weird places. You've seen those like America's Funniest Home Videos, you're going to win some money. Because that's what people expect. People are like, I want to see the kids. I want to see them. They're cute. They're lovable. And that's why we do it, because there may be somebody sitting in this room right now, tonight, that normally wouldn't have come to a church service, right? But somebody drug you along because you wanted to come see some kid on stage, or you wanted to see these kids knock over a Christmas tree, which, by the way, I love the gasp. That takes it out of y'all's breath. Y'all thought that tree was going down. Now, if that tree went down, that would be something to gasp about. But this one, that one was planned. But it was still great. Let me tell you what we did. We thought outside the box. That's why we do this. We want to get you in here. Now listen to me. We're not going to beg. We're not going to plead. I want to introduce you to Jesus and step back and just let Jesus do the rest. Because that's what it looks like when God puts together his own rescue plan. We do this so that you can encounter Jesus just as God thought outside the box to come to the earth in human form as a baby. Just as these four men dug a hole in this guy's roof and lowered their friend in Jesus, we put cute kids on a stage so that you would come and encounter Jesus on Christmas Eve. Listen, in a few hours, I've got five kids. In a few hours, my house is going to be chaos. It's going to be gifts and wrapping paper and all that. Don't lose focus. We do that because Jesus was the best gift ever. And so here's the question I have for you tonight. What will you do with the opportunity you've been given to receive from God the greatest gift ever? Will you accept it? Or will you say, maybe next year? I'm not going to beg. I'm not going to plead. I'm going to introduce you to Jesus and let him do the rest. So would you just pray with me right now? Father God, I love you. And I'm incredibly grateful. And I'm kind of dumbfounded that you give us the opportunity to teach your word. You trust us with your word. You trust us with this idea that salvation is possible to anybody who will ask for it. And so right now, Lord, I'm asking you to speak. I'm asking you to move in the hearts of your people. I'm asking you to move into the hearts of those who are in this room today. And so let me ask you this question. If you're here today and you have never received Jesus as your Savior, you've never surrendered your life to him, you've never received the best gift that was ever given, would you do it tonight? I'm not going to beg. I'm not going to plead. But I'm going to give you the opportunity right now, right where you're sitting, to have this conversation with God. There's no magic words. It is just a conversation. Say, Lord, I get it. I'm a sinner. And I am thankful that you put together a rescue plan to save me from my sins. God, would you forgive me? Would you save me tonight? I surrender my life to you. I accept this great gift that you've given. Thank you for giving it. Now, here's the greatest part of this. The Bible's very clear that when we have that conversation with the Lord and we mean it, and the Bible says that we're a brand new creation, that we're no longer the same that we were when we walked in this door 30 minutes ago. And so I'm not going to ask you to walk the aisle. I'm not going to ask you to stand up, but I'm going to ask you to communicate with me because my role as a pastor is to help you with your next steps. If you surrendered your life to Jesus, I don't want you to walk out of the door and just go, well, that was good. I'm done with that. What's next? We want to help you grow. And so right now where you're sitting, everybody's eyes are closed, mine are not. Would you real quick just stick your hand in the air, make eye contact with me if you had that conversation with the Lord so I can find you and I can follow up with you. Anybody at all? Awesome. Praise God. Anybody else? You're not alone. Praise God for you. I love it. Anybody else? Thank you, Father. I know both of you. And I will follow up with both of you. You got my word. You have received the greatest gift ever. But it doesn't stop here. Let us help you take your next steps. Lord in heaven, thank you for always changing hearts. We worship you. We worship you as a baby. We worship you as King. We worship you as risen Savior. Thank you for what you've done for us. I pray all this in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. I'm going to ask our ushers real quick to start lighting candles on the outside and going in. And as you do that, Let me talk you through something. Remember that bright light I talked about? We saw the bright light in Luke. We saw the bright light. We talked about the light of John. We talked about the bright light in Matthew. Listen to me. The reason that we have the bright light is because darkness runs from the light. And so here, right now, we're going to light candles. And we're going to allow the darkness to run from the light. That bright light, which was the glory of God that shone all around the shepherds when the angel appeared to them to announce the birth of Jesus, that bright star, that light in the sky that directed their path as they were going, that was all to illustrate God's glory. And so as we light these candles, this is to be a reminder of God's glory. This is to be a reminder of God's rescue plan to us. so that we can spend eternity with him in heaven. That is the greatest gift ever. So I'm going to ask you to stand as Tanya sings this song and let these be your words to the Lord tonight.
I want you guys to focus on two things this Christmas. I want you to focus on Jesus, and I want you to follow Jesus. And let that be our prayer tonight as we sing the song together. And the words are up here for a reason, because I want you guys to read and see the words that are being sung.
Tears are falling, hearts are breaking. How we need to hear from God. You've been promised, we've been waiting. Welcome, holy child. Welcome, holy child. Hope that you
Merry Christmas, everybody. Have a great night.
The God.